Bye. Good to be in the house of the Lord once more and again. Oh, we thank God again for another day. Amen. Thank God for just allowing us to wake up this morning.
Yes,
Lord. Hold in our right mind. Oh, we thank you, Heavenly Father, for just being here. As we come again another service today, this is February the 14th. Amen. We are here at Ebenezer Missionary Baptist Church here in sunny San Diego, California. Pastor Jerry Moten is the pastor here at 1728 South 39th Street. Stop on by. Amen. As we began this morning, we'll read from the book of Psalms, the 150th number, the book of Psalms. So praise ye the Lord.
Uh-huh.
Praise God and his sanctuary. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery and the harp. Praise him with the tremble and the dance. Praise him with the stringed instruments and organ. Praise him upon the loud cymbal. Praise him upon the high sounding cymbals. That everything that has breath, praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. As from the book of Psalm 150, number 150 in its entirety, stanza 1 through 6. May the Lord have a blessing to the readers and to the hearers, for that is his holy and divine word. Shall we pray? Oh, Heavenly Father, we come again today, just at this particular moment, to say thank you, dear God, for bringing from the early rock of our cradle up until this very present moment. Oh, dear God, we want to say thank you again, Heavenly Father, for just watching over us all night long. And we laid there slumber and slept, Heavenly Father, in you. Then let the death angels come in among us, Heavenly Father. I pray, Father, that you just keep on blessing, Heavenly Father. And Father, this morning, early this morning, you touched us with the finger of love, Heavenly Father. You woke up, Heavenly Father, we rocked us ever so gently. And we're able to see a brand new day, one which our eyes had never beheld before. But we thank you, Heavenly Father, and we looked around, dear God, that our family was all right around us, Heavenly Father. Cast our eyes toward heaven, Heavenly Father, and we said, thank you, dear God, for having a roof over our head. Dear Heavenly Father, that we began to move, Heavenly Father. Thank you for the movement of our limbs, Heavenly Father. And we said, thank you, dear God, Heavenly Father, for bringing us to where, Heavenly Father. As we went to our cupboard farm, we had food to eat, Heavenly Father. Oh, Heavenly Father, we felt the cool air that cooled our parts and bodies. Oh, we thank you, Heavenly Father, for all that you've done, Heavenly Father. By a thousand tongues, I could not thank thee enough, Heavenly Father. But I realize, Heavenly Father, we may not have always done what you told us to do, Heavenly Father. May not have always, Heavenly Father, walked in the pathway of righteousness, Heavenly Father. But Heavenly Father, I pray, Father, that you would keep your loving arms around us, Heavenly Father. Give us a chance, Heavenly Father, to come back once more and again and praise the holy and divine name. Oh, dear God, we just want to say thank you again for all that you've done, Heavenly Father. Thank you and bless you and bless your holy name. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and thank you, God.
The tempest is raging. Oh, the billows are tossing high. The sky is overshadowed with blackness. Perish. Oh, moment so madly is threatening. Oh, a grave, a grave, a grave in the angry deep. Get up, Jesus.
Call to worship. Amen. The Lord is in his holy temple. Let the whole earth keep silent before him. Amen. As we come this morning, we start out with our chant this morning. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. Will thou teach me how to serve thee? Will thou teach me how to pray? Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Amen. I'm Pastor Jared Moten. I'm the senior pastor here at Ebenezer Missionary Baptist Church, and I'd like to warmly welcome each and every one of you to our service on this morning. I know you had 1,001 options when you turned on the internet this morning, and we are overjoyed that you have selected Ebenezer Missionary. here in sunny San Diego, California, to enjoy the word with us on this morning. We welcome you from near. We welcome you from far. We welcome you to sit back, praise the Lord with us, and enjoy his word. In addition, we welcome you every Sunday morning at 9 o'clock to join us, 9:30, to join us for Sunday school, amen, where we study the Word of God together. Every Wednesday evening from 6 to 6:15, we have our prayer session, and then from 6:15 to 7:15, we have our Bible study, amen. In Bible study, we are entering the letter to the church Colossians, amen, to the church at Colossae. So we invite you to stop by on Wednesday evening as well to lift up the Lord with us. May God bless you, may God keep you, and may he abundantly bless you in your life. Amen.
Good morning. This is our moment in Black history. Every Sunday we do a moment in Black history that we might know and understand the great legacy on which we stand, the shoulders of the titans before us that have made the things that we're able to do today possible. On this morning, we will highlight William Edward Burghardt Dubois. W.E.B. Dubois was born February 23rd, 1868. And went home to be with the Lord in August 27th of 1963. W.E.B. Dubois was an American sociologist, socialist, historian, and civil rights leader. He was a Pan-Africanist, an author, and editor. W.E.B. Dubois grew up in a relatively integrated community, and after completing graduate work, and after completing his graduate work at the University of Berlin and at Harvard, where he was the first African-American to earn a doctorate degree. He became a professor of history, sociology, and economics at Atlanta University. Dubois was one of the founders of the National Association of the Advancement of Colored People, better known as the NAACP, in 1909. He made great inroads for African-Americans. Early in Dubois' career, he had risen to national prominence as the leader of the Nigerian movement, a group of African American activists that wanted equal rights for blacks. Dubois and his supporters opposed the Atlanta Compromise, an agreement crafted by Booker T. Washington, which provided that the Southern blacks would work and submit to white political rule, while Southern whites guaranteed that blacks would receive basic educational and economic rights. He was a leader far before his time, demanding rights and not willing to compromise with those that tried to give us less than we deserved. I mentioned W.E.B. Dubois because not only is his birthday is just a few days, but also because of what he stood for. I encourage each and every one of us never to compromise with who we are and what we stand for. Never allow us to be placed in a secondary role. Always stand up for your rights and for what is right. Today, in our moment of Black history, we salute and celebrate W.E.B. Dubois. Thank you.
Thank you. do us call. Sometimes was in the morning, sometimes late at night. But when I get up off my knees, Jesus, everything was all right.
Amen. Thank you again. Amen. Nice to be here this morning. Amen. Now we come with the litany of Christian stewardship. It's time to give. Praise the Lord. It is tithing and giving time. Praise the Lord. To whom does the tithe belong? The tithe belongs to the Lord, and all the tithes of the land, whether of the seed of the land or the fruit of the tree, it is the Lord. It is holy unto the Lord. Who should tithe? Let every one of you lay by him in store, as God hath prospered. Why should we tithe? Because the Lord said, bring ye all the tithe into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house. What has God promised to the tither? If I will not open you the wonders of heaven, and pour out a blessing, that shall not be room enough to receive it. How shall we give unto the Lord? Honor the Lord with thy substance, and with the first fruit of all thine increase. What has God promised to the giver? Give, and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down and shaken together, and running over, shall men give unto your bosom. For the kind of giver of the Lord love, God love, a cheerful giver. It is more blessed to give than to receive. Amen.
Hallelujah, oh Lord, will sing.
I will sing. Brother-in-law and my sister who have lost a child.
send a portion of this prayer out to my brother-in-law and my sister, and I pray that we continue to lift up the name Brandon Mosley and that his legacy would continue to live with every head bowed and all eyes closed. Gracious and eternal God, our Father, Lord, because we come before your throne of grace and mercy simply to say thank you. We thank you, O Father God, because this day was not promised, but it was a gift from you, O Father, that we were able to open our eyes on this morning. Thank you. We thank you, O Father God, that when we open our eyes, we have a reasonable activity of our limbs, O Father God. It was nothing more than simply just being able to bat our eyes. It was still a gift from you. Thank you, Lord. I thank you that those that I love are still here in the land of the living, Lord. I thank you for my father. I thank you for my brother and my sister-in-law. I thank you for my sister and my brother-in-law. I thank you for my three children, Shanoa Marie, Jared Bradman, and Jordan Reese. I thank you for my grandbaby, Everett Anaiso, Father God. I thank you for the totality of the Ebenezer Missionary Baptist family, church family. Amen. I thank you, O Father God, for shedding down your love upon us. I thank you, Lord, for being in our midst. I thank you, Lord, for just loving us. I thank you, O Father God, because you didn't have to do it, but by your choice, you allowed our golden moments to roll on. I ask in the name of Jesus that you would look and have mercy on those that are sick among us, O Father God. I call the names of Deacon Harris. I call the name of Sister Linda. I call the name of Sister Aaliyah, O Father. I call the name, Lord. Some too many to even mention, Lord, but thou knowest. I ask in the name of Jesus that you would just stop by and touch them. I pray, O Father, that whatever situation that they're dealing with, you would give them God strength to move on in your name. I pray in the name of Jesus that they would have expanded faith, O Father. I pray that they would have belief beyond belief, hope in spite of hope, Lord. I pray, O Father God, that you would touch those that are in the Texas area, Father, that are gone without electricity, Father. I pray for those that are freezing on today, Lord. I pray for those that are cold, Lord. I pray, O Father God, that you be light and warmth for them, O Father. I pray that you would still and stop the mouths of those that are spreading lies about things that are not true. I pray that politics would stop being based on the color of what you represent, blue and red, O Father. They condemn our young men for claiming blue and red, but that's all our politics is claiming, that I'm red and I'm blue, I'm right and you're wrong, Lord. I pray that the divisiveness would end, O Father. I pray, O Father God, that we would go about loving one another. I pray, O Father God, that not only would we go about loving one another, but that we would allow the love of Jesus Christ to spread from heart to heart and from breast to breast. I pray, Father, that we would be honest about what's transpiring with this COVID virus, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you would be in our hearts and our minds. I pray that we would do what's right for ourselves and those that are around us, Lord. I pray for young people on today, Lord, whose minds are so twisted by what's going on, those that are leaning to their own understanding, those that count it important to espouse their own thoughts and not wear masks, those that are being selfish and not expressing their love the way that you would, Lord. I pray, O Father God, that you would allow your kingdom to expand. I pray that during this time, while the opportunity is right, that we would go about spreading the word in the name of Jesus. You said in the word of God that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess. So I pray in the name of Jesus that we would bow and confess before your return. I pray in the name of Jesus that we could claim it while there's still time, Lord. I pray, O Father God, that we would come to a realization that we don't know it all, but we serve a risen Savior that knows what we don't know. I pray that we would understand that we serve a risen Savior who cares for us and has a desire that we would all be saved. I pray, O Father God, that we walk with you, that we the Word of God. I pray that you would go and get your Bibles, your pens, your paper, and I pray that you would be ready for the preached word. Turn your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And let's get ready to go to work in the Word of God. God bless.
If I can hear from you, then I'll know what to do. I won't go on, never go on my own. Just let your spirit guide and let your word abide.
Speak to my heart, Lord.
Oh, my heart.
Give me your holy word.
Glory to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I pray that your heart and mind are ready to receive the word of God. Amen. We can jump up and down all morning long. We can do all that we want to do. But there's only one thing that can save your soul from a fiery burning hell, and that is the word of God. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Jesus is a love song. If you just allow the name of Jesus to resonate in your heart and mind, you will begin to understand the love song I'm talking about. When you just allow Jesus on the inside and you just meditate on it, everything will begin to be all right. When you just let Jesus speak to you, you'll realize that Jesus is a love song. And it is my prayer on this morning that I'm not before you too long. I pray that you have opened your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, and we're going to hit it all. Amen. I pray to do it in a timely enough time so you can get your grub on after the service is over. Amen. I'm going to begin reading in the 13th chapter at the first verse, and I pray that you would follow along. This is Brother Paul talking here to the church of Corinth, and says, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not charity, I have become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy, and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith, so that I can remove mountains and have not charity, I am nothing. And though I bestow all of my goods to feed the poor, and though I have my body to be burned, and have not charity, it profiteth nothing. Charity is, it suffereth long, and is kind. Charity envieth not, charity vaunteth not itself, and is not puffed up. Doth not have behaved itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil. Rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth. Beareth all things, charity believeth all things, it hopeth all things, and endureth all things. Charity never faileth, but rather there be prophecies, or they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it vanisheth away. For we know in part and prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. When I was a child, when I spake as a child, I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now, we see through the glass, darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as I am known. And now abideth faith, hope, love, these three. But the greatest of these is charity. I just want to ask us a question on today. Do you really know how to love? I need you to take an introspective look today. Do you really know how to love? Can you look on the inside of yourself and begin to ask yourself, do I love like Christ loves? Do you really know how to love? Most gracious and eternal God, Father, Lord, we bow our heads this morning. I come to the throne of grace and mercy, Lord, leading your spirit, Lord, leading your God wisdom. Asking in the name of Jesus that you would draw out of me that which you have seated in me, Lord. Allow your people to have open ears, open hearts, Lord, that the understanding might be there to receive your word. This is the mighty and matchless name of Jesus we do pray. Amen. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praises shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make a boast in the Lord, and the humble shall hear thereof and be glad. I just need you to magnify the Lord with me on this morning. I just need you to clap your hands and give a little happy. I just need you to praise God so that the word of God can come into your heart and into your mind. I need you to release your mind from every mundane thing that is not about God, but concentrate on the word on this morning. Why? Because our God is great, and he is greatly to be praised. That our God is great, and he is greatly to be praised. I know that there are many of you on this morning, when I ask you the question, do you really know how to love? In your mind, is set on Jehu. Your mind is set on little Romeo down the street thinking I'm talking about romantic love. But I'm talking this morning on God love, Jesus love, the kind of love that Jesus loves us with. Jesus asks us to love our neighbors just like we love ourselves, which means that when we love our neighbors like we love ourselves, then we're talking about Jesus love. When we're talking about loving those down the street around the corner, we're talking about loving those that don't mean us any good. We're talking about loving those that even when they talk about you, when they misuse your name, when they scandalize you, you're still able to love them. That's the love I'm talking about on this morning. As we look at this 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians, we find Paul talking to the church of Corinth. Paul is talking to them because you had folk that had gifts that were different from others, and they were trying to use their gifts to separate them or to exalt themselves over others, like because they had that gift that they got it on their own. And they tried to make it seem like, because I can do this and you can't, then you're nobody. Because I can sing and you can't, I'm somebody. You ought to go somewhere and sit down. They were making it seem like, because I know how to do other things than God with the gifts that he's given me, but I'm greater than you. That's like the preacher or the pastor saying, I'm better than you because I can preach the word of God. But what Paul was saying here in this 13th chapter is that of all the gifts that one might be given, the greatest gift of all is the gift of love. The ability to love somebody in spite of who they are, the ability to love somebody in spite of what they've done, the ability to put others before you put yourself. I'm just going to give one quick ground rule and then we're going to work. Whenever you see the word charity, I just need you to think love. Charity is nothing more than love, amen. Paul starts in this first verse and he says, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not charity and love, I have become sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. I think some folk might get confused when we talk about this thing called tongues, amen. Tongues is one of the things that people use to separate themselves. Tongues was the ability to speak in a language, a godly language, a language in which one could talk to God with, where God would interact. People were thinking because they could speak in tongues that they were a somebody in the church of Corinth, amen. And Paul begins to set people straight. He says, though I speak with the tongue of men and of angels, and have not love, I am become a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal. I am nothing, even though I have says this, and a certain Jew named Apollos, born at Alexandria, an eloquent man and mighty in the scriptures, came to Ephesus. This man was instructed in the way of the Lord, and being fervent in the spirit, he spake and taught diligently the things of the Lord, knowing only the baptism of John. When Apollos came and he had the eloquent speech, amen, but he was baptized only with the baptism of John. He didn't have the baptism of Jesus. He didn't have the fire deep down inside. He had not been introduced to the Holy Ghost. Although he spoke eloquently, he was not doing and using all that could be used, that the Word of God could be seen, demonstrated, and understood. Even though you might speak well, if you can't utilize the gift that God has given you in love, if you don't have all the elements of what God has for you to utilize to educate his people, it doesn't mean anything. Speak as good as you want to. Do all the things that you think is right, but if you don't have the Spirit of God in you, and you can't relate it in a godlike way, it means nothing. He says, even though he can speak with the tongue of men and angels and have not love, if you don't have the love of God, you become a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal. Even though you can speak all good, it doesn't mean anything. It has no semblance of understanding. It's just without the depth of who Christ is. It's without being able to be understood. And don't think because you sound good that you are getting something done. Don't think because everybody will pat you on the back, because some folks will pat you on the back because you speak good. Don't mean you're no good. Even though it sounds good, if there is no depth in love in Jesus Christ, even if it sounds good but you don't love your neighbor, it doesn't mean anything. I see folks time and time again that I think because when they come into church and they sit on a board, or their mother so-and-so, or their deacon so-and-so, or their pastor so-and-so, but they don't love the congregation, it doesn't mean anything. All of that is just a bunch of noise. We have to love in order that what we're saying to be relevant. We have to love in order that what we're saying will resonate in the heart. Watch this here. If we sing with the voices of angels, but we have not love, and we put folk down and we talk about them, even though folk may jump and shout, it don't mean nothing, because it's not wrapped in the proper thing that's needed, and that is love. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not charity, I am nothing. Paul moves from our ability to speak in tongues, and then he talks about prophecy. He moves to prophecy, amen. He says, and though I have the gift of prophecy, your gift means nothing to God if it does not have love. Even though you can prophesy and you're able to understand all mysteries, have the knowledge of the truth of God, even though you have that but you have not love, you ain't doing nothing, baby. You ought to go somewhere and sit down. Love is that key ingredient, the love of Jesus that binds everything together. That love that Jesus had, that he showed us even in our sin-sick state, that he died for the remission of our sins. And if we don't have Jesus, sitting down is the best thing that you can do until you understand Jesus' love. Sitting down is the best thing that we can do until we begin to love people in spite of what gifts we have. And your gifts, yes, they'll make room for you, but if your gifts have no love, I've said it before, it's like a sounding brass and a tingling cymbal. He says, in all knowledge, even though you have God knowledge, and though you have the faith to look at a mountain that stands before you and say, be thou removed, mountain, even though you have that faith and you have that knowledge of God, if Think about your own actions as you move through your church. Do you love everybody? Do you even love those that talk about you and despitefully use you? Do you love those that have scandalized your name? Do you love those? Ha, help us, Jesus. To tell you, do not anybody spread your business. Don't tell your business if you don't want to spread all over town. Take your cares to Jesus. If you don't have love, it does not mean anything. He says, if you have the faith that you can remove mountains and have not charity, I am nothing. I need you to look at yourself on this morning. Take an inward look at who you are and ask yourself, do I really love? Or do I think more highly of myself than I ought to? If I really have love, I'm going to take time when I'm driving down the street and I see that man standing on the corner. I'm not going to judge who he is, but if my fellow brother stands in need, seems like he has need, my love, the love of Christ, says that I'm going to reach out, that I'm going to help, that I'm going to attempt to make a difference. Says in that third verse, and though bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have not charity, it profiteth nothing. If I have not love to do all of these things, although I can help the poor, amen. Although I can give them that dollar, that $2, I can go and buy food and I can feed them, but if the love of God is not in my heart when I do it, it means nothing. You're just doing it for show and for fashion. What you do ought to have the love of God, and who you feed. When you're feeding somebody, when they're standing in need, it ought to be done in love. It ought to be done in the spirit of Jesus. When folk were traveling with Jesus, and he looked and he found that it was the day was far spent, and it was too far to go back and to get some food, and all they had was several pennies worth of money. Now he looked, and out of the love of his heart, he said, these don't need to go hungry, and he fed 5,000. That's the sort of love that we have to have. Even when you don't have, if you have God's love, you ought to be able to give something. You ought to be able to make a difference in somebody's life. He says, and though I have my body to demur, even though, like the Hebrew boys back in the Old Testament, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they had a love for God, and they said, for God I live, and for God I'll die. And even though you may feel like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and have your body burned, if you don't have love in your heart, if you don't love your neighbor, if you're not willing to give to your neighbor, to sacrifice for your neighbor, it means nothing. It was something impressive to be able to sacrifice who you are and show great love for God, but if you don't love your neighbor, all of those actions are nothing before God but just an act. You don't want to be an actor in front of God. You want to be a true lover. Do you really know how to love on today? Do you really know how to give of yourself? The love that God is talking about, the love that Paul is speaking of to the church of Corinthians, is a love of sacrifice. It's a love of selflessness. It's a love that allows you to be in connection with Jesus. If you're really walking with him, talking with him, and then loving on him, you'll know how to love as he loves. He says, and if I do all of these things, still in verse 3, it profiteth nothing if the love of Christ is not in you. That's the underscoring fact on this morning. Do you really know how to love and love as Christ loves? Do you really know how to love and give of yourself and that others may benefit? Do you really know how to love, that people will look at you and when they see what you're doing and how you bless them? Does your love point back to the Master? Does it point back to the one that died for the remission of our sins? Does your love? Is it done not that you might be saved? seen, but is it done that Christ might be seen and glorified? Paul goes on in that fourth verse, and he begins to tell us what love does. He says, charity of love suffereth long. What does that mean? That means that when it suffereth long, that it endureth hate. When you really love, I don't care how they talk about you. I don't care how they scandalize the name. I don't care how they try to brutalize it. When you really love, you endure that. Amen. You endure like Christ did. It was Christ on the cross that said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That was love. Because he didn't hold against them the whipping that he took. He didn't hold against them the pain of the crown of thorns that was plotted on his head. He did not hold against them the evil and blasphemous words that they said about him. He says, and not only does love suffer long, it is kind. Amen. Kindness is the opposite of that evil which was done. He said, the charity of love, it envieth not. When you really have love, you are not jealous of somebody. When you really have love, you're not trying to imitate the gift they have. When you really have love, you're thankful to God for the gift that you have. You're thankful to God for how he's blessed you in what you have. You don't put brother or sister so-and-so down because they can do what you can't do with the gifts that God has given them, but you applaud them and you usher them on in the spirit of God, in the love of God, that they may continue to use that gift. It says that charity of love vaunteth not itself. That means that it doesn't try to lift itself up, and the love of Christ is not puffed up. It is not walking around because I'm able to sing better than you can. It doesn't look down its nose because I think that I'm all of that and six bags of chips. When you really love the way that God loves, none of that really matters. The question is, do you love and show your love like Christ did? I don't care how good you think you might be. I don't care how many people give you accolades. I don't care how many awards you might have had. I don't care what the district says or what the state might say about how good you are. If you don't have the love of Christ in your heart, it doesn't mean anything, baby. I don't care. All of those things will still land you in a fiery, burning hell if you don't have the love of God. Do you treat your neighbor as good as you treat yourself? Do you lift up the gift of your neighbor the same way that they exalt you in what you are able to do? Never let the press of what man says fool you. Jesus said it this way, that I know man. And basically, because I know man, I know only inside of man there's nothing good. And then don't get caught up and don't get fooled about what people tell you, how good they think you are. Don't puff yourself up like you're doing something that is all that great, because what you have is a gift, and that gift was given to you by God. He says, he talks about the characteristics of what love is. He says, it does not behave itself unseemly. Amen. It is courteous. When you really love, you are courteous to your fellow brothers and sisters. You are courteous to those that you meet because you want them to join the family of Christ. It does not. When you are really exhibiting the love of God, it is not uncourteous. It doesn't tell the kids just to sit down and shut up because I said so. But when you really love, it explains to people why there is such a rule. And when you explain the rule, explain it in love. That there's somebody that is coming in the church who is hurting. There's somebody that's coming into the church that has never had a relationship with God. If we act unseemly, as if we are all of that, we damage the opportunity for that person to be saved, for that person to receive the joy of Christ, for that person to be made whole in Jesus. Says that love seeketh not our own, is not easily provoked, and they have wronged you, you still pray for them. When folk are not at their very best and you really know how to love, you're willing to reach out when you really know how to love. It says in that sixth verse, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in truth when you really know how to love. Amen. You are not sitting around rejoicing when calamity falls upon somebody. When you really know how to love, when somebody falls into a situation that is not a good situation for them to be in, you don't rejoice because they're down, but you show them how to rejoice in the truth of God. When somebody has fallen due to things that are going on in the world, when you really love, you say, they'll go out, but by the grace of God. And as you say, after you say that, then you go to help your neighbor stand on their feet. You help somebody stand on their feet because you love Jesus and the love of Jesus is in you. Because if you were in that situation, you'd want somebody to help you. You'd want somebody to give you a break and give you a hand up that you might be able to stand. He says that love beareth all things. It believeth all things. It hopeth all things. And it endureth all things. When it beareth all things, I don't care what is placed on the person. In all things, they're able to endure because the love of God is with them. It believeth all things because they believe it because it's of God. And they believe all things because everything when it's done in love points to Jesus. It says that it hopeth all things. It sees the good in everything. Love sees the good in every situation. Even when folk have given up on themselves and even when folk have given up on love, love and hope in God allows them to be able to stand. You should always be able to encourage your neighbor in love where they can bear their situation, where they can hope against all hope because Jesus make anything work out for the best. And it says it endureth all things, even in persecution. When one is persecuted and they endure all things, they're able to endure the persecution of their situation in love. That they're able to bear it without complaining. That they're able to endure. How did the Hebrew boys do it? They said, even though you may place me in the fire, even though I may have to go in, I still know that my God is able. I don't care what your situation is. I don't care if you're sitting in Texas right now and you don't have electricity or your electricity is rolling. Sometimes it's on and sometimes it's off. You endure that situation knowing that your God is able. Even though death might have come and knocked on the door of your house and taken somebody that you love, you're able to endure it. Because love is able to fix all things. Even with a broken heart, the love of Christ will overtake it. Says charity never faileth. Charity. Love is always faithful. Love will never fail. Love will never leave you. What was the promise that we had? Jesus told us, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Love never fails. When you love in Christ, it is always there. It will never stop. Just watch this. If you really love Christ, you may endure some heartache and some pain here, but if you're a child of God, the love of God will endure through eternity. If you really love it, I don't care what you go through down here. When you get up there, God, you're in his presence and you're able to see mama again and you're able to see daddy again and you're able to see your Savior face to face. His love has endured. He says, love believeth all things and it hopeth all things. I'll drop back down to 8. if you have love, it will abide with you even in eternity. It's like that American Express black card that you can take anywhere. You can spend an American Express black card. When you got love of Christ in you, it will go anywhere that you go. There's no time limit or expiration on the love of Christ. There is no limit when you have the love of Christ. Amen. I'm almost done. We're getting to the end of this. Amen. The only thing that has the ability to last is the love of God. But it says, but when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part, it shall be done away with. When that which is perfect is come, that which is fragmented, that's what it means in part. When you don't know the whole portion of it, that which is fragmented, amen, it will cease. For the love of God will still stand. It says, when I was a child, I spake as a child, and I understood as a child, and I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. But brother Paul was saying here that when I was an infant in the word of God, when I understood like a child understood, when I was just new to Christ, I spake like somebody that didn't really know him, because I didn't have the full measure on the inside of love that I needed to love, the love that goes from heart to heart and breast to breast. I was still a child in Christ. He says, and I understood as a child. I was still one that when somebody talked about me, I had to talk about them back. If they kicked me, I got to kick them and the dog. That was being a child in Christ. But he says, and even when I acted like that, he said, I thought like a child. I thought like I was still doing right in the Lord. I had the shape, form, and fashion of a fig tree that was fully in bloom, but when the Lord came to inspect what was on me, all I had was leaves. There was no fruit. I was still a child, but when I grew up in the Lord, when I really began to understand who he was, and there began to be some fruit. Why? Because I began to love on others unconditionally. I began to give from my heart to those that stood in need. I began to walk like Jesus walked. I began to talk like Jesus talked. I began to grow that fruit that God may be pleased with who I am. When I got older, I put away those childish things. Love was able to be seen when they came and they looked at me and they gave careful inspection. The leaves were there, but so was the fruit. I had grown up in the Lord. Do you really know how to love? Do you really know how to put aside those things and stop thinking that you're all that and because of the gifts that you may have, and say that God gave them to me and I'm going to use them for the purpose of God, and those gifts mean nothing other than something to share. They don't make me. It's the love of God that makes and shapes it. It's the love of God that lets you know when you exhibit that who you really are. It says, for now we see through a glass, darkly, but then face to face. Now I have put in, now I know in part, excuse me, now I know in part, but then shall I know even as I am known. When I'm still trying to know in the present, amen, it's dark, and I'm trying to know in the present. I don't have a clear understanding of who he is. I don't have a clear understanding of what this love means. But when I really know how to love, then when I know how to love, I really know of God. But when I really know how to love, the Jesus that is in me begins to emanate out. When I really know how to love, then I know that the blood of Jesus has fully dripped from my head down to my feet. I'm no longer walking in who I used to be. I'm no longer talking like I used to talk, with the love of Christ. It emanates from the inside to the outside. shares divine is the one that's on the inside. You're able to say that it should be evident in who I am. Faithfully will I run in the name of Jesus. God has changed who I am on the inside. He's the one that has helped me understand that the love that I exhibit ought to be the love of Christ. When you have really know how to love as in Jesus love. I don't care who comes to you, what comes at you. The only thing that they get from you is the love of Christ. Do you really know how to love? I encourage all of that, all of us, from the pulpit to the back door, from the left side to the right side, to examine ourselves. The same Paul that wrote this says in Corinthians as well, he said, let a man examine himself. And when he examines himself, he can't be judged by anybody else. Do you really love? Take a look at yourself today and allow the love of God to stand higher than any gift that you have. Let the love of God speak for you greater than you can speak for yourself. Let the love of God emanate to all those that are in your presence and in your sphere of influence. Father in heaven, we love you, Lord. We thank you for your word. We pray, Lord, that you would search us. And as you search us, Lord, I pray that we would search with you, that we might understand what is really on the inside, that we might really understand if we love as Christ loves. And then, Lord, as we do the examination, if there's anything in us that is not like you, that we are not exhibiting the love of Christ, allow us hearts and our minds to be open to really love as Christ is loved. It is in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Do you really love? This is a display at this time of how we love you, because we are inviting you to join the family of Christ. This is a demonstration of our love because we want to extend to you the joy that we have in being in the family of Christ. It is your decision time to either choose or to reject your Lord and your Savior. I have two questions for you, that your soul might be saved from a fiery burning hell, and by answering yes, it will allow you to come into the family. My first question is, do you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is your personal Lord and Savior? If you believe so, signify by saying yes. Amen. You're 50% of the way there, and Christ is now, the angels in heaven are now tuning up. Second question, you believe that Christ lived on this cold, cruel world, and he died, he went to hell, but he was risen from the dead by the power of God, and that he's alive today, sitting on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. If you believe so, signify by saying yes. Amen. For all of those that said yes to both of those questions, I have an announcement for you. You are saved. It is not that difficult to be saved. You just have to confess with your mouth and have the belief in your heart of who Jesus Christ is, and that he was risen from the dead and is alive today. Now, now that you're saved, a couple things that you need to do. Number one, I need you to find a Bible-teaching church. Amen. We extend ourselves here at Ebenezer Missionary Baptist Church, located at 1728 South 39th Street here in sunny San Diego, California. If you're in San Diego, come and join the family here. Learn the Word of God. Sing praises unto him, for he is worthy to be praised. Now, after you have joined the church, and if you're in another city, just put comments in the chat section, amen, stating the city and state that you're in, and we will direct you to a church where you can fellowship with, amen, and I pray that if that church is meeting your needs, that you'll become a member. Once you have become a member of a church, you need to be baptized, amen. That means that you are symbolizing to those on the outside an inward change that has happened. You are dipped in the water, and you were submerged in a water grave, as Jesus was in a borrowed grave, amen. When he rose grows as a new creature. When you're risen out of the water, you become a new creature in Christ. Who you used to be, you're not anymore. Amen. Don't be upset because some folk are not going to believe it. Amen. They still want to hold you as the person that you used to be. But when you are risen as a brand new person. You're a new person now in Christ. Amen. Once you are baptized and you join the church, I encourage you to do two things. To read your Bible daily so that you thereby may know the benefits and the gifts and the package of being a child of God. And I encourage you to have a strong prayer life, because if you thought you had trouble now, when you leave the enemy's side, I'm sure if you were like I am, you were a good soldier for Satan. Now you join God's team. He's not going to let you go easy. He's going to try to pull you back. Death is still destined for you there. But if you have a strong prayer life and you ask God to give you the strength to resist the devil, you'll be able to stand in Christ and march forward as a new creature in Him. Find your church home. Become baptized. Read your Bible daily and pray daily. And everything will be all right. I pray that today's service has been a blessing. I pray that the Word of God is resonating on your heart and on your mind. And I pray that you would keep your mind stayed on Jesus. Amen. Our hearts and minds are clear. I pray that we depart from this place, wherever this place may be, but never from the presence of God. Father God in heaven, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your loving kindness, and we thank you for your tender mercy, Lord. I pray now in the name of Jesus that all that have heard this message come to an understanding of how to really love, how to know how they love by watching your example. I pray, oh Father God, that you would give strength to those that have committed their life to Christ someday. I pray, oh Father, that they would find a church home that would meet their spiritual needs. I pray, Father, that they would begin to read the Bible and study your word. Pray in the name of Jesus that they are strengthened in you. I pray, oh Father God, that there is a permanent change that will walk forward, continuing towards you. Now, may the grace of God, his love, and the sweet holy communion, I pray it progress through the body, so now and all together we say, amen.